I just wanted you to know that I love you always. At number 2, World Trade Center, right? Ladies and gentlemen, we're not ready to die, but it's getting bad. Oh, God! Oh!
I'm on the 83rd floor. I'm gonna die, aren't I? No,
say your prayers.
Stop.
We're gonna think positive because you gotta help each other get off the floor.
I'm dying.
A new type of war. That's what it is.
It kinds of shocks you, makes you think, what is happening around us? This is maybe a reminder that we need to be very careful, very watchful about what is happening around us. And today we are discussing the subject on Afghanistan. Syria to Afghanistan, lesson Europe must learn. Viewers, it is felt that it is the rerun of Syria. From Afghanistan, people are fleeing and almost all of them are Muslims. They are not running towards Muslim countries. They are all wishing to go to European countries. In case of Syria, the pattern was same. Those countries which engage their boundaries and share their boundaries with Syrian refugees are showing very disturbing signs of demographic imbalances, cultural disharmony. The sex crimes have increased there with general lawlessness. Refugees pose great threats and challenges due to cultural differences, lack of social assimilations, political disagreements, religious fundamentalism, and their unwillingness for social integration and refusal to love the nation they chose. There are few important lessons Europe must learn. The discussion on above lines are happening in various different platforms. And today we have very eminent expert to discuss same subject here also. The discussion on above lines will be with Professor John M. Nomikos. He is Ph.D., who is also director of the Research Institute for European and American Studies. In short, it is called RIEA. He is chairman European Intelligence Academy, EIA, and founding editor of Journal of American Intelligence Studies, Journal of European and American Intelligence Studies. He is head of the history, politics and international relations department of Athens campus of Webster University. And he is assistant professor. He is member of advisory board of Master Security Studies and Information Analysis at the American University in the United Arab Emirates and a fellow in International Association for Counterterrorism and Security Professional. He is a member of editorial advisory board for the International Journal of Intelligence and Counterintelligence. Dr. John Nomikos, you are welcome to the discussion. And this discussion is being conducted under the banner and platform of International Council for Industrial Security and Safety Management. May I request you to make your opening remark, please?
Thank you, Captain, for the great opportunity to be today in the show. And ladies and gentlemen, we need to remember that today is number 11. Number 11, 2001, We had a tragedy, not only in the United States, but for the rest of the world. We never need to forget this day, and we'll do anything we can globally to prevent such an action. So for the United States, today is a day that everyone must remember. And we need to work as a group in order, you know, to protect the safety of our citizens. But today, as the captain said, our agenda on this critical day, 9/11, is about Afghanistan. And we need to discuss the issues that after the withdrawal of the USA armed forces on 31st August 2021, many Afghani citizens abandoned the country, and they are looking for a better life. And most of them are moving toward Caucasus, Caspian, through Iran, all the way to Turkey. And from Turkey are using the first European border, which is the Greek island and the Greek-Turkish borders, to come to Europe. Just to refresh your memory, allow me to say, ladies and gentlemen, that in 2015, we had one of the most dramatic crises in Syria. Syria was in a situation that millions of people were enforced to leave their home, to go to Turkey, and from Turkey try to come to the Greek island primarily, or to go to the Greek-Turkish border. 95% of the Syrian refugees who came to Europe, first stop was Greece. Well, as you know, Greece is a small country. It's a democratic country, the fatherhood of democracy. We are a full member of the European Union since 1981, and we are a full member of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO. However, Greece has many Greek islands in the Aegean and Mediterranean Sea. And that was extremely difficult for the Greek Coast Guard to board the European borders, because Greek borders, captain, is European borders. And we find out with a big surprise that the tsunami of the Syrian refugees who came from Turkey to the Greek island primarily, and secondly to the Greek-Turkish border, were almost impossible for the Greek authorities to control this human crisis management. The Greek authorities were caught in surprise because we were not prepared to, you know, handle all these human beings coming to us. And along with the Greek unprepared condition for this crisis management, European Commission, who was in charge of all the orders coming to the member state, captain, the European Commission and the rest of the member state were caught in surprises too. But when they decided to act, they did only that by offering funding to the front line Greece in order to accommodate these people, you know, temporarily, and try to build up, captain, hotspot most of the Greek island. But this is not this was not a solution, you know, for the accommodation of the Syrian refugee. This was a temporary solution, that unfortunately these temporary solutions trapped the Greek authorities, you know, to keep the refugees there for a long time, because their attention to them was not quite well, and most of the Syrian refugees did not want to stay in Greece, but they want to come through Greece to go primarily to Germany, to France, to the Netherlands, and the Scandinavian countries. Well, the dream did not come to the reality because, you know, after a long time, 6 to 1 year, they find out that it was not easy to leave Greece and to go to other European Union member states. The European Commission did not move fast in order to create a European migration policy as a common standard policy for all EU member states. So what we did really find out is that because of the lack of the European Union common migration policy, all the 27 member states, excluded UK, act unilaterally in their own way. So Greece had the biggest burden to deal, which is we always need to remember, Captain, this is a humanitarian crisis. When people are under stress and they need to leave their house, you know, in force refugees, and they come to us, they have no choice but to move. And the Turks, of course, realize that this is just a humanitarian crisis, but at the same time, is a political maneuvering and tool to blackmail the European Commission on how to receive the most of the funding from the Commission to them. Of course, we have to realize that in that kind of cases, human trafficking, organized crime, para any kind of services, you know, in the covert action, you know, join forces, you know, to take advantage and manipulate, you know, the poverty and the how to sell hope, you know, all to these desperate people who were under stress to move and to look for a better life. And of course, Mr. Erdogan, as president of Turkey, you know, acquired and blackmailed the European Union to receive more than 5 billion euro in order to, you know, support with a humanitarian assistance on the Turkish Syrian border. Of course, one of the biggest deficiencies in the Syria crisis in 2015 is that Europe, you know, could not, you know, keep the member state to receive a percentage of the Syrian refugees according to the population. What I mean, the Hungarian government declare we receive no Syrian refugees. All right, some other countries said we receive only a small portion of the Syrian refugee. This created more confusion, more disagreement, you know, among the member states, and everybody said it's almost impossible to control not only the people who come to us, but to control the sleeping cell of a terrorist network who were coming as refugee, you know, from Syria to all other members of the, you know, EU. So Greece was unilaterally acting without having a lot of support from the neighbor country, because Serbian, who is not a member of the EU, closed the border. Bulgaria, who is a member of the EU, tried, you know, not to receive as many people as they could. The same happened with the Albania and other countries. So we are really had alone to find a way, you know, to accommodate all these people without creating, you know, social, you know, turmoil, which was really, really very hard. The Greek population and the Greek island were frustrated because they saw, no matter what, how many hotspots we built there to accommodate the people started to come, you know, through Turkey. They used to come, you know, from Turkey to the Greek island, and the Greek government was really in a very difficult situation, asking for the European Commission to provide assistance from the other countries in order to accept, you know, peoples, you know, that come from Syria. That was not sometimes, that was not very successful. Eventually, you know, Germany, you know, opened its border to accept as many people as they can. And many people from Syria, they move up north to, you know, Netherlands, Belgium, Denmark, and Scandinavia. But until now, this Syria case studies is a learning process. And now, Captain, what we see in Afghanistan, we see in the same scenario comes to Europe. A question that we need to make, Captain, did European learn anything from the Syrian refugee crisis? And is Europe ready to accept the Afghani, you know, political refugees today? Unfortunately, right now, I think we come to a situation that panic is back to us. Because right now, the first Afghani refugee came to Greece through the Greek-Turkish border. The information that we have in Greece is that more than 3 million Afghanis is on the way to come to Europe. Now, Captain, I would like to have the intention to our lovely audience that in Germany on 26th of September 2021, they have a national election, and the German will go to vote 2 weeks from today. As long as we watch the election campaign in Germany, we see that the Social Democrat is going to win. And the Christian Democrat, the Conservative Party, that Mrs. Merkel, who is the Chancellor of Germany, will probably lose. And third party is going to be the Green. And we might see, hypothetically speaking, a small increase of the right extremist party. That means German voters are worried about the new tsunami of Afghani political refugees moving to Europe through Turkey via Greece as the Syrian crisis in 2015, which has a lot of similarities with the Afghani, you know, tsunami in 2021 towards Germany. So the Afghanistan and the Afghani refugees, dear Captain, is going to affect the German elections. And the Social Democrat might win. And another thing, in coming years, French election is coming up, and other states, other European states are going to have elections, like in the Netherlands, so on. So this situation today with the Afghani refugees might bring a nationalist party back to powers in Europe in the coming years. And one of these reasons is that, unfortunately, a European Union should examine and research the Syrian crisis in 2015, come in these 5 years from 2015 to 2020 with a strong European Union migration policies. They should ask all the member states to prepare for such a policy in case. Yes, Captain.
Please continue this and I'll ask a question after that. Please continue, your friend.
Okay. They should take advantage of the time in 5 years from 2015 to 2020 to come up with the pre-requirement from all member states to establish a European Union migration policy. Until now, which 9/11/2021, we don't have that. And we have a second case studies, the Afghani, that they come to us because of the collapse of the Afghani government. How we are going to deal with this case studies, the Afghanistan case studies? To be honest with you, I see right now most of the European leaders, tried to see how to solve the second crisis. Are we going to act spasmodically and leave again the EU member state like Greece to act unilaterally? Or having such initiative like Afghani refugees fly from Kabul to Istanbul or from Kabul to Tirana in Albania in small numbers to be accommodated by Albania, who is not a member, of the EU. This is not a solution. This is a spasmodic solution to the problem, because the large number of the Afghani people comes, is on the way. And like I said, national elections are taking place now in Germany and eventually in more countries, which might break, as I said, nationalist parties and the government. And this is going to be quite different for the European Union to accommodate such large number. And as Capt said, most of these people who come here have a different way of life. They're not Westerners. They're not assimilated to the Western way of life. They are Muslim. And usually when they come to Europe, they will be asked to be assimilated and to live under their own constitution in the country they choose. And as we see now, sometimes it's quite difficult for them to totally assimilate, and they make a little ghetto inside the countries, which might create some problem. So far, people from Syria, refugees, because they were not only Muslim, they were Christian too. In Syria, we had, many Syrian Christians and Muslim, but after a long time, of course, they tried, now to assimilate. But in the case of Afghanistan, it's quite different because the social democracy there is going to be quite different. We might have, cultural differences. We might have some religious fundamentalism. And one thought that comes to my mind is if Taliban allows people as extremists or as radicals to travel with the rest of this Afghani refugee and they come to Europe eventually to have a different role or to be like a sleepy cell for future activities. Because remember, in 2015, one of the biggest problems we face is that we had foreign fighters from Syria come to the Balkan state and to the rest of Europe and vice versa. And now many counter-terrorism unit in the European Union worry about the increase of extremist act coming from the new wave of these Afghani refugees. I'm not saying that these people will come there to create problem, but I'm just saying that it might be people inside, you know, the Afghani refugees migrant that might take advantage of the beginning of this people assimilation in the countries they decide to choose. And I remember the former Minister of Culture in Afghanistan who, you know, advised the Greek authorities that the possibility to have suicide attacks in European cities is highly possible. Now, to us, this is something extremely new. We never have suicide attacks in Athens or to some other European city. But now we have, you know, psychologically to prepare for that. I don't know. This is something that the former Minister of Culture said that in a Greek interview in the Greek newspaper. And I think I should share with you because we might see a new type of extremism in Europe that we never had in a previous, you know, terrorist incident, you know, like, you know, in Al-Qaeda in March 2004 in Madrid or 2005 and the London, you know, metro. So we need to prepare for any kind of different types of extremism here in Europe. And of course, we need to fight. Yes, yes, Captain.
Sorry that I interrupt you, Doctor. I feel compelled here to make a comparison, Syria and Afghanistan. Syria is a Muslim country. Afghanistan is a Muslim country. Syria's geological, geographical position, Afghanistan's location, all around Muslim countries. In case of Syria as well as in case of Afghanistan. In distress to save their life, what is more natural for refugees to run to? Which country they would naturally run? The countries which are of their own religion, the countries with which boundaries are common and crossing over is easier. While you were making your statement, I checked the maps of Syria and Afghanistan and their surrounding countries. It is amazing to think that some refugees, to save their lives, would not go to few kilometers across the border to a Muslim country, but rather prefer to go 1,000 kilometers away to a Scandinavian country. Maybe Austria, maybe Germany, but it was part of their planning, the ultimate destination to which they wanted to go. And I see a design here. Do you also see similarly, which I see, or maybe my vision is a little impaired?
Well, Captain, you are right. And many Europeans always thinking, how come the Muslim refugees from Syria or Afghanistan do not go to the Muslim countries like Saudi Arabia, like Iran, and they have the same religious principle, the same, you know, faith, should be Sunni, Shiite, whatever. But it's a big surprise to us. We don't see any Muslim. Most of the Muslim refugees do not, you know, do not choose to go to the neighbor countries like Pakistan or like Iran or like Turkey. But the majority of the people, they want to come to Europe, which is, you know, primarily, you know, Christian. And most of the European Union member states accommodate them as much as they can, because we see all these people as a humanitarian crisis. We don't grade the people of the religious. We don't say that you are a Muslim, you cannot come. On the contrary, we see the humanitarian aspect. You come to us, you know, because your life is under threat, and you ask for a political asylum. But I remember when I interview some people here in Athens, I always ask them, how come you don't go to a Muslim country? And they say to us, we don't want to go to a neighbor countries because we don't feel safe. I was quite surprised. I said, if you leave Afghanistan and you go to Pakistan, you don't feel safe? They said, I prefer to live in Sweden than Pakistan. Now, to me, was quite, you know, quite a big surprise, you know. But to them, they didn't want to live in the countries that they have the same religions for their own reason, everyone, which I don't know. But always they want to come to Europe, you know, regardless of their religions. But they thought they come there to have a freedom of express, freedom of choices, a better way of life, you know, and a better access to the educational or social services. They look at Europe as a European dream. Remember when many people used to go to the Americans, you know, in the 19th and 20th century, and they said, we go for the American dream. Well, these people came to Greece, and they thought by coming to Greece, which is a member of the European Union, the European state, European Union, it's part of the Greek dream or part, you know, of the European dream. But in Europe, did not have all the benefits that the American used to offer to the people, you know, when they arrived in the United States. But to them, it was a relief, get out of their own countries, accepting not to go to the Muslim neighbor countries, but to come to us, you know, for freedom. Everybody said to me, you know, to us, we want to have freedom. We would like to be here, even though we don't speak the language, even though we are Muslim, we want to feel safe. And then I said to them, you don't feel safe in Pakistan? They didn't reply to me directly, but they said, we prefer to be in Greece than Pakistan. Just to give you an example of when I interview the people, you know, what's quite, you know, a surprise for me to see that all Afghanistan, from Kabul, they have to come to the other part of the world, like Alexander the Great. When he decided to leave Greece, he went to Kabul and he said to his general, this is a long distance for us to come to this country, even though we go through to India. We have to turn back. So to me, a refugee leaves Kabul, goes to Iran, goes to Turkey, comes to Greece, and goes to Germany, is a life journey. It's a life journey. But they prefer to do it because they have two words that I always say, safety and freedom. Now, these people might know something more than I know or we know.
Back to Germany and Angela Merkel. She opened the borders and fencing were demolished, gates were opened, garlands were ready, and refugees were welcome in Germany. Very soon, she went to press and shared her anxiety, saying that I do not know what has come to our society. Rape cases have increased, murders have increased, looting and arson is very common in Germany. And such innocent lady, she had no answer to the problem she was facing. Such innocence. Same innocent lady is once again opening her arms, so to say, to welcome refugees. These refugees have been known to go to country of their choice, pleading that they were victims. Recent terrorist, which was gunned down, was refugee in Sri Lanka, sought asylum there, blaming that he has been subject of sodomy by mullahs in Madrasa. And from Sri Lanka, he went to European country and killed the people for same religion, which made him a victim. In Paris also, in front of mall, a Pakistani refugee went on rampage, shouting, God is great, and killed. So question is that there will be refugees, human tragedy you have mentioned, but once they settle in their chosen country, that those countries need to understand that there might be elements which may be detrimental to their own cultural identity and their own internal security. The lesson learned in case of Syria have not been shared so eloquently. And maybe if there are lessons shared, countries have refused to learn. So let us repeat the lessons. What are the lessons learned in case of Syria, which are also applicable in case of Afghanistan? What are those two, three major points you would like to share with our audience?
Well, Captain, the lesson of what we learned from Syria is that, number one, we should prepare, for another tsunami like Afghanistan that happened today, all right? Number two, we should, like I said, we should have a common standard for every EU member state. Number three, we should have created infrastructure to accommodate more migrant in all member states, not only Greece, all right, or in the Balkan state. And number four, we need to have a warning mechanism to predict, that a new wave of migrants might come to Europe. All right. This is the lesson that we should, learn from the Syria, crisis 2015. Are we prepared for the new wave of migrants like Afghani that it came a week ago because of the collapse of the Afghanistan? This is something I cannot honestly reply to you, because we have to see in the coming weeks how the European Commission, who is, running or give a directive to the EU member state or to the European Council, is going to solve the problem. Because the people now from Afghanistan are getting inside, the Greek land and more numbers to come. However, which is very important, now Turkey and Mr. Erdogan is having a million of people from Afghanistan, and I'm sure he will bargain diplomatically if he's going to leave these people to come to Europe or again demanded by blackmailing money from the EU in order to keep there. But the Afghanist citizen again is becoming a tool for the Turkish diplomacy. But at the same time, the situation now is quite different from the Syria case studies, because the economy in Turkey is deteriorating. There is a lot of xenophobia and racism in Turkey by refugees from Afghanistan as well as from Syria. So the situation might become to some extent a volcano. And the Europeans right now started to see how Turkey is going to act by having the Afghani citizen go through Turkey. And Erdogan always said that we're not going to keep all these people here, but he doesn't say what he's going to do. So the situation right now, again, is repeating the same kind of situation that we had in 2015. Fortunately, or unfortunately, Europe could prepare for such a crisis and should study all the consequences we had from Syria in 2015. And to be honest with you, we should have prepared much better, you know, to handle such a crisis as the one we face today in Afghanistan, with a better strategy, and activate all the EU member states to accept as much as they can by offering a percentage. The European Commission should say every state will accept this number of Afghanistan citizen as a humanitarian crisis according to their population, because Greece is 11 million people. If we accept 3 million from Afghanistan, this is a huge number. And really, we cannot offer social services to all of them, because we used to be 8 years under financial crisis. At right now, The coronavirus is a biological virus. It does not allow us, you know, to offer as much service as we can. Even though we want to assist all these people, sometimes it's beyond our control. Greece is a migrant country. Every Greek has a migrant all over the world, like India, all right? They are migrant in the United States. India has migrant in UK, everywhere. But do not expect from one member state who used to be, you know, a front line because of the geography. We don't have any other choice. Geography is here. 95% come to us. And if these 3 million people come to Greece without offering to them, at least for 6 months, basic services, and, you know, accommodate them, offer humanitarian crisis, offer the vaccination for these people. They cannot come here without vaccination. You know, they need to get some vaccination, right? Because of the coronavirus. I mean, who is going to assist us to offer humanitarian crisis? And as much as we can, if we don't have a commission, you know, help all the member states, and especially Greece, who's in on the front line, as a European border to accept. We don't need only the Frontex with the EU Coast Guard to come here, you know, to, you know, protect. The point is, when people are enforced to move, Captain, you cannot stop them. You cannot stop them. They will find a way to come.
But Doctor, Greece unfortunately suffers the locational disadvantage. You cannot avoid it. Anything goes wrong in this vicinity, people will come to you. You have faced exodus of Syrian coming to you to Europe. Now you have seen Afghanistan, and you better be ready for Pakistan. So in Syria, in case of Afghanistan, there is one element which is very gleefully anticipating situation for it to capitalize, Turkey. Turkey has got everything to gain and nothing to lose. They always extract their pound of flesh. In case of Syria, you mentioned $5 billion. Now also. So Turkey remains common element in case of Syria, in case of Afghanistan also. But another big daddy of bargaining of refugee crisis is China. China cannot be discounted, but remain focused on Turkey, because I remember a very old statement of Erdogan, and he said, what is ours is ours. What is not, we will claim. For me, it seems part of the design that all these refugees must be channeled through Greece to go to Europe, not to Muslim countries. Because what is ours, and what is not ours, we will reclaim. So this seems to be a concept arising out of the desire of Erdogan to become Khalifa of Islamic world. And how Muslims do not try to assimilate with the culture and lifestyle of the countries they choose is for one reason. I may be wrong, but one concept of Islam is not agreeing with the principle of nation state. They don't believe in a geographical limitation of a nation. So wherever they go, they remain attached to their core belief. So whatever attempts of assimilation you might try in different countries, but their basic nature remains unchanged. You have to deal. European countries, when I say you, it is not particular country, but I am addressing to European country. Better be ready, because these are the lessons, very stark and bold, in capital letter, written lessons. They have to learn that their approach to refugee must change. Their policy, you have already highlighted, must change. So I ask another relevant question here, that human tragedies have been known. India also have given shelter to refugees. We have given shelter to Bangladeshi, we have given shelter to Rohingyas. And we face a lot of difficulties. Bangladesh only yesterday declared that they will not accept any Afghanistan refugees. What are the compelling reasons for European countries to compromise their identity and independence? This is the question I want to ask.
Yes. Captain, I've been to India, which is one of the countries I really admire. And I see, the Muslim population in India. If I were in India, I would worry, what kind of extreme from Pakistan or from other Muslim countries come to Muslim population in India to destabilize the harmony and the peace between the Indian citizen and the Indian citizen who are Muslim. Why I'm asking that? Because I see the close relationship right now between the ISI, which is the Pakistani intelligence service, and the Turkish intelligence service meet to work together how to break, people in order to destabilize in the long term European societies by creating minorities in the European societies and manipulate the harmony and the balance of these people for a new life by creating social turmoil. The people come there to have a quiet life. And you see, you know, two countries, Turkey and Pakistan, you know, bring there some parasite, they try to infiltrate people in order to create extremism, destabilize the societies there, destabilize the harmony of the Muslim community who live in European societies, and make, you know, the citizen of the state to go to the extreme, you know, and have, you know, a cultural conflict. So this is something that the Pakistanis, you know, could try to do it, you know, sometimes in the Muslim population in India. But I'm sure Pakistanis and Turkish have, you know, an agenda how to do the same in Europe. So many European states, like France right now is alerting on the French citizen, Muslim, who try, you know, by creating ghetto in a French city to go against to their own, you know, comrades who are both French, you know, and who's really put a little bit fire on the Muslim community in the French Muslim, you know, minorities. You know, the French government is keeping an eye on the Turkish extremists who travel to France in order to destabilize Muslim community, because French interests and Turkish interests, you know, are in disagreement with the East Mediterranean oil and natural resources. So you can see that countries like Pakistan and Turkey are manipulating the fear and the panic of the people that they have to live in Greece, and they go to live in a country, they want to be quiet, they want to start their life from the beginning. But unfortunately, you know, these two countries always find a way to create a problem inside the Muslim community. And this is something that the counter-terrorism and counter-intelligence services, you know, attempted to prevent. And we are going to see the same situation, you know, with the Afghani, you know, migrant. You know, the many counter-terrorism branches prevented, you know, people who used to come from primarily from Turkey and Pakistan to Europe to create fire, to create problem, to create culture, you know, problem. So I think because having Afghani come to Europe, I think that India has a strategic role. What is the strategic role? Is to provide security and intelligence sharing to the rest of the European Union member state, including Greece. Because we in Greece don't know what's going on the security field, on the street, what's happening in the countries like, you know, in Afghanistan. We have an embassy there, but okay, we need people on the ground. Who has people on the ground? The intelligence service in India. This is a professional intelligence service role. They know what's going on in India. They know what's going on in the Muslim community in India. They know very well what's going on in Pakistan, in Uzbekistan, in Kazakhstan, in Kyrgyzstan, because this is the geographical, you know, area they need to focus on. If you ask us in Greece, we can tell you what's going on in the Balkan. All right, because it's a neighborhood. But if you ask us what's going on in Kashmir, we don't know, because this is not our area. We know, we learn from you. So, so India is a country who could protect, you know, the safety of the European citizen by having the security and intelligence community, you know, closely collaborating with the Europeans, in special with a country like Greece, who is on the front line. We don't expect Pakistan to talk to us, because the Pakistanis are working closely with Turkey in order to promote their own interests. The only country that European Union, including Greece, can depend on preventing terrorist activities or extremism in Europe is India. It's not China. It's not Bangladesh.
I'm sure the kind of real-time intelligence must be shared. It is being shared. There are platforms. BRICS meeting has recently happened. Quad is another platform. And there are other channels to share real-time intelligence. This must be happening. I am very confident. But how accurately these intelligence are being worked upon is another question. It is not that intelligence is always, you know, found to be worth working upon. As intelligence professional, you can appreciate much better than the common audience of this discussion. But there is a question which has come on my mobile phone through WhatsApp, and the person has chosen to remain anonymous. That's why that question is not shared through the platform. And he says that it was inevitable that Pakistan ISI role would be discussed. And that brings Ghazwa-e Hind under sharp focus, and the desire of Islamic believers for dominance of Islam world over. Nizam-e-Mustafa, he has referred. So it is inevitable that what is happening in Afghanistan is being watched, analyzed, and is still not being commented upon for the possibilities of Ghazwa-e Hind and impact of Afghanistan over India. But then that is not, I suppose, part of the focus of our discussion. But you can still comment about it if you feel like.
Okay. Well, even though I'm not really an expert on the area, I think, you know, as far as I understand, of course, and you have to, you know, to excuse me, you know, the limited knowledge of the area. But as far as I know, you know, the Afghanis today, after the Taliban regime, are to some extent, some of these members that they are trying to form a government today, they are at remnants, they are coming from the Haqqani terror network, all right? And so they have already experiences in terrorism, which is tomorrow they might be foreign minister or a defense minister. So this is one of the problems that we have to pay attention to, see how this new form of government consisted of Taliban is going to go on. On the other side, as a gentleman said that, you know, Pakistan and the Talibanese, the Taliban-Pakistan always have a strong collaboration with the new regime. Therefore, I think, as far as I understand, the Pakistan is going to have a tremendously impact and the new regime in Taliban, no matter what you call them. Now, we, of course, they changed the name. They call them the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. Instead of the Republic, now we become Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. So they changed the name. They have a new identity. Most of the members, are, as I said, they're coming from the Haqqani terror network. So I think Pakistan, especially the security community and the military community, might affect a lot, you know, the future of Afghanistan. But here, I think you know, the India government must keep an eye on what's going on in Pakistan before they look as a second eye to Afghanistan. All right. Did India caught surprise by the change in Afghanistan? The answer is no. But certainly, Pakistan, who is under the economic penetration of China, because the Chinese are looking to the port, you know, like the Greek port, like the Pakistani port, they are looking to the port, and the Chinese have already, you know, bought some of the port or controlled some of the port in Turkey. All right. So what we see here, Captain, is a undercover strong connection between Pakistan, China, and Turkey promote their own Muslim agenda to some extent, using the economic power from China, and China is doing that for their own interest. Chinese interest is economy. They don't care about religious. But Pakistan and Turkish are doing anything, you know, to find a way to have a tremendously impact on Afghanistan because of the mineral. And Pakistan is trying to open the political agenda for China to come in. However, there is one strategic advantage here. India is the largest democratic country. India is a nuclear weapon. India has a nuclear weapon. They have strong armed forces, and India has the trust and confidence from Western states, United States, European Union, you know, Greece, all of them. So India, we see India as a country of stability, as a country of collaboration, a democratic state, you know, in a neighborhood that is more or less many problems. And allow me to say that sometimes I feel that India is surrounded by wolves, you know, that they are ready, you know, to see it or to smell blood. So as India is a paradise of stability because it's the only democratic state in the region. That's why I said how important it is to have critical information, you know, each other in order to prevent activities. And I do believe that India sooner or later is going to be, you know, a country that will need to advise us, you know, how to deal with a new tsunami that we have to face, you know, because without exchange of information from a country that knows what's going on, it's almost hard for us to solve the problem only financially. We need, okay, to provide the premises, we need to provide the services, but we need to have information to prevent terrorist activities like the one that the Pakistanis attack Mumbai. Okay, this kind of activity, we might have it in the future. And we don't expect Turkey or Pakistani to assist us or Bangladesh to assist us. The only country we expect, you know, to help European Union is India. And I work a lot to talk to the European Union decision maker and to the Greek decision maker and to the Greek government that you need to go to New Delhi to talk to the people there now, not tomorrow, now. Don't make the same mistake like you did in Syria. Syria was a different case. Now we have Afghanistan. Afghanistan is not Syria, but they can create more problem that we had to deal with, you know, Syria.
Thank you, Dr. Nomikos. There was a recent visit in Greece, and I am sure here also in public domain, few outcomes of that discussion, fruitful discussion, we came to know. Very recently, a seminar was organized on Hindu phobia. People ask me that Indians are paranoid. And I say, why not? we cannot afford to be complacent. All our neighbors are hostile. All our neighbors are untrustworthy. They always play deceit and fraud. So we need to be very careful. And for similar reason, we also wish well to all the countries in the world. And that's why we say with folded hands, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, every one is part of me. Entire world is my family. But we need to remain very, very concerned and cautious. Today, we observe the details of 9/11. We share the sorrow, pain, and tragedy of the victims. 26/11 again is going to be a stark reminder to what terrorism can do. And all this while, we have been seeking help of experts like you to understand subjects in right perspective. I am sorry that few questions were intentionally provocative, but you handled them very well, which is so confidently expected of an expert of your position. Doctor, so kind of you that you spared your very precious time and discussed this important matter with our audience. We are soon going to organize another similar talk on energy security, emerging leadership in Asia and in European Union. Energy security is going to be something which will impact all of us. And the role being played by China is going to again impact all of us. We cannot ignore. CPEC, OBOR are very ambitious projects. They will affect all the countries in the world so far as their dependence on energy is concerned. So with my viewers, I would like to share that this is the subject we have already lined up. And Dr. Nomikos, I'm sure that you might be having willingness and content to share with us. Separately, we can discuss the subject. But I close this discussion. And in the end, I can only thank you very much.